Hello, everyone. I'm astronaut Mike Mullane. I'm a 1967 graduate of U.S. Military Academy at West Point. I took my commission in the U.S. Air Force. In 1969, I was flying in the back seat of the F-4 Phantom jet and completed 134 combat missions in Vietnam. In 1978, I was selected in the first group of space shuttle astronauts and flew three space missions. Welcome to my program, Stopping Normalization of Deviance. Now, the way I want to kick off this program is to bring you along vicariously on a space shuttle launch. So for the next few minutes, I want everybody to suspend disbelief, pretend that we're all fellow astronauts, we're going to fly a mission into space. Around 3 hours before liftoff, we'll walk from the crew quarters, climb into the crew van, drive to the launch pad, take the elevator to the cockpit level, exit that, walk across the access arm. What do you think your heart rate is right here? I guarantee you're gonna feel every beat in your throat. It'll be choking you. In the white room, we dress in our harnesses, then we get down on our hands and knees and crawl into the cockpit. Technicians inside will help lay us back into our chairs. They will strap us those chairs, and then as they leave, the side hatch will be closed, the access arm will be retracted, and we will be left alone. And while we're awaiting launch, we're going to be in the grips of two fundamental emotions, one of which is fear, gut fear. We will fear for our lives while we're out there. But at the same time that fear is on us, we're going to be boundlessly joyful, because for most astronauts, it truly is a lifetime quest to make this flight. And with that at hand, we're going to be overwhelmed with joy. At T-minus 6 seconds, the three liquid engines start. When that occurs, we get this heavy vibration in the cockpit. At T0, the hold down bolts blow, the solid rocket boosters ignite, and we're slapped into our seats with a force of about 2 Gs, 2 times gravity, as the rocket leaps from the launch pad. At 2 minutes and 12 seconds up, the boosters burn out and separate, and when that occurs, we hear a loud bang, and we see this whip of fire across the windscreens as these things are pyrotechnically separated. And then we continue into space for another 6.5 minutes on the... Now, I wanted to share that narrative with you to set you up for this question. If we had not been pretending, if this had been for real, if all of you truly had been tied to 4 million pounds of propellant, what type of a team would you want out there holding your life in their palm? Clearly, in situations like this, where you work in a hazardous environment, your life is on the line, and by the way, that is an everyday work occurrence for most of you. You're in that regard, you're like astronauts every day taking a flight into space. But in these circumstances, whether it's doing your job or flying into space as an astronaut, it's a hazardous environment and you want a world-class team holding your life in their palm. And teams get to be world-class when every team member is living these or living safety fundamentals. Now, the three that I want to discuss in this program are guarding against a normalization of deviance, define that term here in just a moment, making certain we take each other's backs, and making sure that we count in all circumstances, at all times, we count. Now, before I go further, I want to make sure we're all on the same page when it comes to values. Values define who we are. We do not practice our values because we are told to do so. We are fiercely self-motivated to live our values. To give you an example, every day you live a value of watching out for the care and well-being of your family. That is a top value for all of us. Now, imagine one morning I came to you and said, hey, Joe, Mary, make sure today that you watch out for the care and well-being of your family. What would you think? You'd be offended because that value defines you. And so it must be with practicing safety values, living safety values, and one of which is guarding against a normalization of deviance. Now, what is this? It's repeatedly shortcutting safety best practices until that behavior becomes your new normal. Now, it's always schedule pressure that's pushing us into shortcutting safety best practices. And certainly we got the pressures of work. It's the nature of work that we're under pressure. There's an expectation we're going to get the job done. But it's more than that. We drag our humanity to work. We can't leave it at our home. And our basic humanity burdens us with some very significant pressures. We got the pressures of family, the pressure, financial pressures, relationship pressures, health pressures. And all of this can push us into shortcutting safety best practices. To give you an example, let's say it's a Friday afternoon. You're out doing a hazardous job and you're looking at your watch and you're thinking, man, if I can just wrap this up, save some time, I can get home and take the kids to the ball game. So you start thinking, how can I save some time? You put yourself under schedule pressure. And you answer that question, well, I can save some time by skipping some of these procedures. I can save some time by not wearing PPE. Heck, I've worn PPE 1,000 times doing this job and have never needed it. I certainly can get by without wearing it today. So you take those safety shortcuts. And what the danger here is, normalization of deviance leads to predictable surprises. You get away with a shortcut over and over and over, becomes your new normal. It leads to predictable surprises, and you can just write in your worst nightmare right here. Whatever can occur is your worst nightmare. I'll tell you what it is too. It's injury and it's death when you operate in hazardous environments. Now, the Space Shuttle Challenger disaster in 1986, which killed 7 astronauts, was a graphic and classic example of what normalization of deviance can do, frankly, to a terrific team, great team, NASA Apollo team. And it occurred, Challenger occurred because of a 4-year shortcutting of safety best practices. So I'm gonna tell you the story of Challenger so we can derive some lessons from this story to better protect ourselves from being victimized by normalization of deviance. Challenger was a result of the failure of the right-hand solid rocket booster. So that's the story of Challenger. What do we learn from this story that can better protect us from being victimized by normalization of deviance? The second lesson from Challenger is right here. Risk has no memory. Risk is not being diminished as a function of your success in repeatedly taking a risk. I think we as humans have an incredibly difficult time getting our heads around this. We tend to believe that a risk taken is a risk diminished, and it does not work that way. As an example, now let's continue with the discussion of this safety value, taking each other's back. I want to start a conversation on this value by taking you to this moment in a launch countdown where you're being strapped into that cockpit. As I said earlier, you're going to fear for your life while you're out there. People hear that and wonder how you can accept that fear, how you can go back multiple times, take multiple missions into space. How do you deal with that? And the answer I give is, I think, the identical answer that every astronaut would give. And that is, after working for years preparing for this mission, working around the EVA trainers, the SIM trainers, launch control, mission control, the payload people, you learn that everybody on that team supporting you lives this value. I will not fail these astronauts. I have their backs. And when you're on any team that's working in a hazardous environment, and you can look left and right and know that everybody you're seeing has your back, and they can look at you and know you have their back, what does that do? Let's wrap this up with a discussion of this final safety value, you count. I found that reality embodied in this quote by somebody famous, read it years ago, don't remember who it was, but it's a quote you ought to tattoo on your brain. One person with courage forms a majority. What that means is you can make all the difference to the safety of the team. You might save somebody from an injury. You might save somebody's life because you're seeing something that everybody else is missing. And so this requires you see something, say something, do something. You don't depend on others. You count equal to everybody else when it comes to safety. So you bring it forward yourself, get it on the table, your observations, your concern for the team and the leadership to consider. And this is particularly important to practice given the generational change in the workforce that's occurring in a lot of industries that operate in hazardous environments, probably many of your industries. There's a changeover in the workforce. The old guard is retiring, new people are coming in, and there's going to be some overlap in these hazardous work environments. And you might, you might be working next to somebody that has 30 years of experience and you have 30 minutes of experience out there on that same work site. And you might think that counting is somehow a function of age and seniority, age and experience, that this person next to you. That concludes my safety program, and I hope that everybody will take these safety values to heart, that you will incorporate them into your personal value system. Guard yourself against normalization and deviance. Take each other's backs and make sure you count, and leaders, make sure the people you lead do count. I wish you Godspeed on your life journeys. Stay safe.